A very warm welcome. Good evening from here, and great to be with you this evening on this topic, beauty and the real beast. And this session will be interactive. You're very welcome to share your ideas and thoughts in the chat. And also, if you would like to come into camera, because it is a bit like a kind of living room fireside chat, I think Eric would like to say. And about the subject, the beauty and the real beast, possibly a story we all knew as children, but a very interesting moral about a young prince cast under a spell, which could only be broken with true love. So it's nice to think what that means for us today, and perhaps to understand the story a bit more with depth. I like this quote by Margaret Wolfe Hungerford, at least it was attributed to her, that beauty in things exist merely in the mind which contemplates them. So it would be great to understand this, but also what is the real beast? And first of all, I'd like to introduce our two discussion panelists, and Eric Le Reste is connecting with us today from Canada, and professionally he is working for the Canadian Broadcasting Corporation, CBC, and that's been more than 30 years, and also for 35 years he's been involved with the meditation and philosophy of Brahma Kumaris, which he's currently acting as the Canadian coordinator. And we're also going to Rome, so it's from afternoon to later evening, and she's from the UK and professionally was part of the Olympic ski team for Great Britain in the early 60s, later became dancer, choreographer, including working on dolphin show, which just sounds like a lot of fun. She also came across Brahma Kumaris in the early 80s and set up the first center in Italy, which was in Rome, and in a couple of years later, and she's been based there ever since, and contributing through courses, talks. So this is opportunity to meet and share and enjoy this story. So I'm going to first invite Eric, who I think was the brainchild of the title, and maybe share your thoughts. And then after that, we'll go to Wendy and have discussion. So good afternoon to Eric. Welcome.
Well, good afternoon, everyone. And greetings from Montreal, yes, in Canada. Happy to respond to your invitation. And happy to be matched with the real beauty. So I'm the real beast, if I understand the story. And Wendy will be the real beauty. So we'll play the game of the beauty and the real beast. So it's a beautiful topic. And I think we can relate to it in many different ways. Maybe to set also the context. I know Wendy kind of. We've been bumping into each other for decades in India, maybe sometimes elsewhere in the world, but this community of the Brahma Kumaris is such that I think we become friends, you know, with many people from around the world. So it's lovely to connect with you, Wendy, and exchange on this entertaining story of the beauty and the beast. And I'm happy to play the role of the beast if necessary. Also, I think I'd like to say hello to each and everyone listening now, or maybe in 1,000 years from now, when you find this little video somewhere on your planet, we're on Earth, happy to say hello and then share that moment with all of you. The title, Beauty and the Real Beast, is just an excuse, I think, to talk about the multifacets of the soul, who we are as being. And I think each one of us carry within himself or herself. Belle, I think that's how we call her, right? Even in English, right? We still call her Belle, which is her French first name, Belle, and the Beast. And I'm sure we'll have a little chit-chat with Wendy, and I'm looking forward to know how she decodes the story. But to me, I think it's a question of facing both sides of me, a feminine side and a masculine side, both that have been broken in a way and needs to be fixed. And they are fixed by being together and by meeting each other. And I think that Belle has to face the Beast, and Beast has to conquer the heart of Belle. And it's a beautiful story. And we believe in the philosophy of Raja Yoga that almost every story that has been written, particularly, you know, powerful and stories that stay through the time, you know, they can pass the test of time and they remain as beautiful 50 years later after being written. And so all the stories are basically our own stories, and they belong to the inner story of the self, and either being Sleeping Beauty or Beauty and the Beast or Snow White. I mean, these are the famous ones for us, but then in India, they have their own stories. In China, they have their own. So these stories remind us of our own personal story. And this morning in class, we were referring to another story called Jonathan Livingston, the Seagull. Some of you may have seen that beautiful film, and it comes from the book, of course. And I remember being very zealous in my young days of Raja Yoga when I was probably 21 or 22. I just started the study of Raja Yoga. And when I understood the power of the soul and how the soul wants to become greater than just this ordinary seagull, I felt, this is me. I'm really Jonathan, and I want to fly higher, faster. I want to reach the light. And then they were playing the movie, Jonathan Livingston, the Seagull, in Montreal, in a very old and, you know, kind of art theater. So I created the little leaflet and I wrote by hand, "Who is Jonathan? Do you know you are the real Jonathan? If you want to be the real Jonathan and fly at the speed of light, come and understand Raja Yoga meditation." And I put the phone number, and I went at the theater, and I was outside the theater and in those little leaflets. And I was so excited that nobody came, of course, and they all thought I was probably a lunatic. But I really liked this idea of being Jonathan, the Seagull, of being the little prince, and yes, today being Belle and the real Beast. So, dear Wendy, what is your special eye on that story? And so nice to share these moments again with you.
Hello, Eric. Hello, everybody. Good evening. I must admit that I was a bit perplexed, actually, when I saw the theme, because, you know, I knew Cinderella and, of course, Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs and all of this. But Beauty and the Beast somehow passed me by. I mean, I'm 81 now, so it was just after the war when children's stories were the sort of thing I might be reading. And obviously, Beauty and the Beast was not something that came on my list somehow. But I vaguely remembered the idea of the beauty being a very good-looking, very pretty princess, and the beast being this person with fur on his face. In other words, he had an animal head. And at the time, as a child, when I heard about it, and I never read the story, I've always been very keen on animals. So I thought, you know, having fur, I mean, that sounded great to me. I mean, I always thought it was a bit of a bore getting dressed and undressed. So, I mean, I rather liked the idea of fur. And I couldn't understand why they wanted to remove the spell from him. So, but on the other hand, you know, of course, obviously, in a more spiritual vein, I can see what it means, like very much like what Eric was saying, you know, but actually basically very much on how beauty has that capacity to see what is good in the beast and to zoom in on what that is. Where other people just see the defects, she can see what there is underneath. And of course, we all have both the bad and the good within us. You know, we are all a bit both-sided. And I think it's spiritually one of the greatest qualities that we can have is that capacity to zoom in on what people or anybody it is that we have around us, be it our families, especially, of course, those people that live very close to us or that we work with. It's very good to be able to zoom in on their qualities and sort of allow their defects. It's not that you're unaware of them, you're aware of them, but you don't let them take over your mind. It's not that that identifies you, identifies the person with you or you with the person. And I think that's probably one of the best ways to keep a relationship in a good condition when you can do that. It has two sides to it from what I can see. First of all, it keeps you in a very positive frame of mind, which is wonderful in those senses, whatever is happening. If you have the tolerance and the patience to go beyond what might be the defects that are coming towards you, but it also enormously is probably the greatest act of charity you can give, because you're helping the other person actually identify, because you're identifying them with their qualities, so it helps them identify with their qualities. And so you create a sort of a very positive frame of mind for them. It helps them enormously. And so, I mean, those were the things that were coming out for me, when I was turning this and thinking about now who the real beast was. And I got into a completely different thing. And looking at the daily news and really working out what was in the world today, the things that one reads about that are really beastly, and getting completely sort of off the fairy tale kind of thing, and there I think there again in the news there are things that can uplift you and there are things that can absolutely dash your feelings to the ground completely. I mean, it's the most extraordinary period to live in. There are great divisions between what you can see that is positive and what little there is and the negative that one can see. It's extraordinary, actually. So that I was thinking of the real beast and what that might look like, in the world today. So that's as far as I got. I mean, I was really much, very much sort of expecting this conversation to illuminate me a little bit more about the actual story, because I actually went on internet to try and find out what Beauty and the Beast was, because having been brought up in different countries immediately after the war, I didn't have much contact with these kind of things. I mean, my staple was Donald Duck and Mickey Mouse. I mean, and in fact, there was a good reason for that, because my parents, I had very bad eyesight and I was in the middle of having two eye operations, and they preferred that I not read. So I wasn't likely to be given books, And of course, Donald Duck and Mickey Mouse, that you can go along on the pictures. And so that was acceptable reading matter for me as a kid. But a completely different thing, if you really want to help yourself learn a language, try Mickey Mouse and Donald Duck, because actually the people who write those things don't want children to learn to write or anything particularly wrong. So it's actually quite clear language, but it's very simple. And so you can learn a language very quickly by indulging in Mickey Mouse and Donald Duck. I used to do that in the beginning in Italy when I wanted to learn Italian a little bit better. And people used to stare at me on the train because I was 60 something, maybe, reading Donald Duck. You know, it looked a bit weird, but it's the way it is. It works.
If I may, Wendy, and sorry if you agree, I think that we can also direct this conversation, Wendy, about the power of true love. Yeah. And to me, the story of the Beauty and the Beast is also, it's fascinating because it has all the, how to call them, Freud and Jung's element of psyche. Mm. Belle is basically protecting her father. When she accepts to pay the price for his father or her father stealing a rose in the kingdom of that beast. And so the father was supposed to be in jail and he was supposed to be punished for stealing the rose. So imagine the symbology. It's like the little prince with his rose. So the father wanted to steal the rose for his daughter, by the way. And so he got punished. So she offers herself as a sacrifice to the beast to save her father. And then she finds herself in this kingdom where all the objects are moving and all these cups and teapots and everything is moving. The clock is talking, the bed is moving, and all the objects are actually moving and talking. And the beast got this fur and this terrible feature because he was very arrogant and he rejected a princess that came to his door disguised into a beggar and a poor lady, very ugly lady. And she came as a very, very ugly lady to ask the priest, the prince, the priest, the prince, to give her shelter and food. But he was so arrogant of his wealth and his beauty. He was an extremely handsome prince, but so arrogant and vain that he rejected that princess disguised into an old lady. And she was actually, I don't know if you say that, a witch, but she could have magic powers. So she cast a spell on the beast, I mean, on the prince, transforming him into a beast and telling him that only when someone with a true and pure heart shares her love for you, will you be able to return as a prince. But there was a time frame, and the rose again became a symbol of time, and the rose had to remain fresh. But if the rose were to die before someone confess her love for him, then he will stay forever as a beast. So it's a very symbolic story, but to me it's about how Belle, as a young princess, very beautiful, with a pure heart, will have to overcome the obstacles of maintaining that pure love. So she has to protect her pure love from fear, from illusion, from all kind of tricks that, of course, are being happening in the story. And him, as a beast, has no pure heart at all. He's on the contrary. He just has a very beautiful body, but a broken heart, a heart that is vain, that is arrogant, that doesn't know how to love properly. And so he will have to overcome the disillusion of his body and relearn to heal his heart. And to me, I think that this is the work we do in spirituality. When deep within, I know for myself, Belle is there in me, you know, with a pure heart, who would be willing to protect my dad or someone I love from everything. But that pure heart doesn't know how to stay pure in the face of negativity in the world, conflict with people, lying, betrayal. So many things happen that sometimes make the little pure heart disappear in the self. And the beast comes up with a strong ego of being pretentious and arrogant and snob and whatever you want, and losing the ability to love for the right reason, to love with a pure heart. And I really love that story because for me, it tells me that in one hand, I was always desperate to find that pure love in my life. You know, before I became kind of a yogi or in the yogi school, trying to become a yogi, I was a passionate French guy, you know, trying to be having the love of all the movies and better than Walt Disney. And you know, I was very, very passionate, very romantic, and very idealistic. And I was hoping to find this love that was actually totally unreal. It was just impossible in that world. And I got disillusioned so quickly and hurt so badly that I gave up really on the idea that a pure, beautiful relationship is really actually possible. And in Raja Yoga, I was told that, no, I mean, you have to regain, you have to reconquer your own self. And my inner pure heart has to deal with my ugliness, because there was a lot of ugliness, my ego, my arrogance, my personality that was very not perfect at the time. And I have to relearn how to love my defective self. So I don't know if you like this idea, but I think that notion of love, you know, is very much at the heart of the story. And we're dealing with healing our heart, finding a way to have pure love for the self and having pure love for others. So I don't know how you've been going through your many years. I can't believe you're past 80 now. You're eternal princess.
but do you remember that story from childhood? I mean, that whole thing. Do you remember? Because yeah. I mean, I looked on the internet very honestly to try and find it, but you know, I couldn't find I couldn't find the story of the Beauty and the Beast.
Yeah, I remember, because they made a very, very famous French film in black and white that I saw when I was a kid. And I've read the book many times. I've seen different versions. The most modern versions are, of course, very, very well Disney-like. And but the story remains, that's the beauty of the story. It just doesn't change, you know? And yes, they all end up the same way. Snow White, Cinderella, Beauty and the Beast. They will end with this magic kiss, you know, that will transform the whole thing. And for me, I think the kiss is about my spiritual birth. When the soul awakens spiritually, it recognizes the real princess and the real prince within itself, but it has to be ignited by a higher energy that comes to me. So here is the yoga part of our story. Mm-hmm. But I'm sure you must be connecting with many other stories, because they take us all to the self eventually and to the realization of my own self. And I'm sure you must have had in your 40 years of Raja Yoga a whole adventure of going from heart attack to heart healing to heart transplant to, you know, we go through all the phases in our spiritual journey, taking our heart into many shapes. I don't know, what's been your story about healing your heart and learning that pure love that emanates now from your wisdom of your age and your time on this beautiful journey?
Oh, very definitely. I mean, the whole journey for me started a long time before Raja Yoga. It probably did for you too. I mean, that query as to who I was and what I was meant to be doing in the world, and what we were meant to be doing here too, because I felt that it was most strange that man could put but possibly people on the moon, but that they didn't know what they were doing here and where we were going with all of this. You know, I mean, I had very definite queries, but I also had very definite feelings about the way things looked like they were going to end up. But I didn't think that it was terribly positive personally. And there, for example, the whole situation changed when I came into contact with Raja Yoga, because I saw the beauty in what I had actually seen, is that there is a transformation possible. You know, one thinks maybe there isn't, one thinks that everything's going to pot, as one might say, you know, but on the other hand, there is, the spirit of humanity, is reborn somehow in certain challenging situations. And I had a lot of challenging situations also before Dhyan, actually. And so I was wondering how all of this was going to pan out. And of course, coming into Raja Yoga, you learn certain things, and you also learn that, you know, you can actually climb up the ladder that maybe you've slipped down. You know, you can actually change, and all those sort of beastly qualities that you can see in yourself, and the sort of feeling of despair that one might have in certain cases, you know, just then disappears when you realize that there is hope in sight. And I think this is a message that is very important. This idea of hope in sight is an important message for people. I mean, I felt totally I must say that, you know, you were saying about the kiss. I mean, I really did feel that my whole destiny had changed when I came into Rajayoga. I mean, to be actually very true, I'd always been very, you know, self-contained and very independent, etc. And I personally had never really hoped for what they call here is, you know, the blue prince, the Principe Azzurro, you know, the wonderful prince that was going to come and whisk me off my feet and marry me and all this kind of thing. I'd never really believed in that somehow. But if I wasn't going to believe in that kind of a story, what was I going to believe in? I don't know if you see what I mean. It was more of a challenge in a certain sense, because I found it difficult to relate to what was actually going on with myself. And I could see so many areas within me that would be very challenging within relationships. And then coming into Rajayoga and learning a little bit more about the self, I'd been very interested in psychology beforehand, but that didn't sort of give me all the answers that I needed for a possible change within myself. And Rajayoga really gave me sort of, let's say, dreams that I didn't have before. I'd not gone into that kind of a thing. Maybe I just felt that I was lucky that the war was over when I was a small child. I mean, that was very possible, because as a young kid, I used to play in the bomb buildings in Germany. We were living in Germany at the time for a whole period, and you know, hope in the future. In the future, it had a different context in my childhood. So you had to learn to believe in yourself, which is not a bad thing, actually. I didn't expect anything of life that I couldn't give a lot of energy to. I felt that it would demand that I be very participatory in anything that I was doing, you know, which I suppose led to a not particularly light childhood. On the other hand, I had wonderful enjoyment and wonderful, if I look back on it, an absolute wonderful life. And I had a lot of good life before I actually came into contact with spirituality. I mean, a lot of the members of my family thought that my life had stopped when I came into spirituality, because I'd done so much and done so many different things beforehand. I suppose trying to find out what I was capable of and who I was, you know. And then all of a sudden, once I discovered, you know, spiritually who I was and meant to be, all of a sudden it looked like I stopped doing anything. And this my family didn't particularly sort of appreciate. They were rather worried. They got rather worried about it. But in many ways, I'm very glad also that I had that opportunity to live at least 42 years of my life before I came into spirituality. So, I mean, that is something that I remember. And it was a period that was actually, you know, you were living in a situation that you didn't really know what the outcome would be. And I didn't have those dreams. I just thought, let's hope I can manage to make this to the end, you know, make it sound positive. So I was not sort of much of a dreamer when it came to children's books. I mean, I enjoyed them, but I wasn't a dreamer, let's put it that way. And so, you know, that was my experience. And so this whole idea of Beauty and the Beast, of course, obviously, I transposed it into what I personally am doing and what we're all doing, basically, at the moment, because I mean, we're all basically in the same boat, actually, climbing back up the ladder. And it's quite challenging, but there is the beautiful outcome in front, which I didn't have before. That was true. You know, so
maybe that's why I ended up in television. You know, for me, those stories, I wanted to produce them and to produce them in my life. But also then I found that my profession took me into creation of a reality, you know, through television, through documentary, through stories. And so maybe that's why I went to the stories with dreams and vision, but I like the contrast between the two of us. And you know what I really learned for me in terms of you know, how does, I was going to say digging out or emerging the beauty from the self, but killing the beast in a way, was for me as a man, so as you know, someone in a male's body, was really to confront my whole ego interfering with love. And it takes a long time to reconciliate, you know, love without ego. Because very often, for particularly in a male body, love becomes a possession. And what you love, you own it. And that's the ego trying to be possessive over what you love. So therefore, what you earn or what you own. And taking away the ego from love brings love to a new aspect, you know, a new appearance, which is a love that you cannot possess. It's a love that you cannot control. It's a love that you cannot direct. It's just love is there and the ego wants it, but the egoless soul, the egoless self, admires love, respects love, dances with love, smiles when love is there, smiles when love is gone, and remains very, very happy with or without that love. And for someone in a male's body, I think it was a little bit difficult to deal with that. And the ego wants to always, you know, grasp things and name it and put my name on it particularly. So I realized that ego was making me, as a young person, very judgmental, very critical. Some would say, well, typical French, but yeah, I was like that. And I was very, very, you know, I would meet someone and I feel like I had a scanner on all the time. You know, the person would speak and within 10 minutes, I would scan the whole thing. Their social background, their way of dressing, their way of thinking, their level of intellectual capacities, you know, and conclude very quickly, yes or no. And very judgmental, very critical. And so then the more I find that that ego was taking over, the less the love was able to express itself and feel safe and secure and long-lasting. I remember being in a relationship and thinking, okay, this may be the relationship of my life. It's wonderful. And the next day, suddenly I became very critical of what the person told me. And I felt, oh my goodness, just 2 days later, I'm already challenged. I don't know if I last the whole life. And being on the street with that person, I was attracted by others thinking, oh, maybe this is better. Or maybe I can get more with this one. And that's when I stopped and I said, Eric, you're sick. You have a trouble. It's not going to work like this. You're not going to make your prince and princess story long lasting. You don't go with the right start. And honestly, if I didn't have a spiritual awakening, if I didn't go into a spiritual journey, I feel sorry for myself. I think I would have been into serious trouble trying to create a proper relationship, healthy relationship. And when I came to, you know, Raj Yoga, I was told, okay, this is a very deep learning school. You're going to learn a lot. But then lately, a friend told me, I think we're unlearning more than we're learning. And I realized today that I had to unlearn everything that my ego taught me about me, about others. And when I had the judgmental mind, I had to unlearn the judgment to tell myself, no, don't think that way. Maybe it's not like that. And I find that, you know, by trying to really address this issue of changing ego into an open door that allows this beauty to come up, and the beauty to me becomes then the opposite dimension, where I had to have faith in my original true self. And we're told in Raj Yoga, you are a pure soul, but very messy and very damaged and very dirty. And you've just been covered up with a lot of mud and dirt. But remove the mud, and underneath, you are Belle. You are that beautiful, pure heart. And I was very strong, you know, I've always been a bit struggling with that, thinking, I understand intellectually, okay, I'm within a pure soul, but everything I see in the manifestation of who I am is not a pure soul. Very negative, angry, and, you know, I don't know if anyone listening has ever tried to remove anger. Good luck. It says, try to be tomorrow morning, no more anger ever for the rest of your life. That means no impatience, no intolerance, no irritability, nothing, no anger. Try it. It's not easy. So how can I be a pure bell, a pure soul? And only, to be honest with you, only the last few years, I'm having sometimes a little voice in me who I start to believe. And I start to go from the first principle, I am a beautiful, pure soul. I'm a very loving soul. That's who I am. I'm a very peaceful soul. And I have to unlearn everything else that will tell me that I'm something else than that. And it took me a long, long time to come to that point. And I realized that my bell was actually scared of my beast. Mm. And that my inner faith was shaken up by the roaring of the beast, you know, from time to time. And when the beast will be roaring, Belle will be hiding in a room thinking, oh, maybe, you know, maybe he's a beast. Mm. And not to believe that he's a beast is unlearning the teachings of the beast. And I find that both are necessary to heal each other. I think for me, my beast needed to discover the inner beauty of the soul, to find the strength to tame the ego and to tell the ego, it's okay, just quiet, not like a very, you know, angry dog, you know, you have to tame it and just quiet, quiet, quiet. And sometimes it bites you and says, okay, I didn't get it. Okay, next time I try and quiet. And today I feel my ego is a monstrous, gigantic beast, but I'm starting to hear it snoring now. And I prefer the snoring of the beast than the roaring of the beast. And so I like my beast to be starting to sleep nicely. I say, yes, thank you. Okay, now you're quiet. And finally, the bell and the beast, you know, can be together. So I find the journey we're on, I think, is admirable because it takes courage. You know, we say the soul to be able to love needs power. It takes power, not attachment, not attraction, not dependency. That's easy to love under influences. But it takes courage to love from a pure heart, because we need to really, like you said in the beginning, we have to go beyond all the illusionary aspects of the other person. And that means to kill the judgment, the judgmental mind or the judgmental intellect. So I don't know, Sarah, if we're doing well in telling our own impressions on the story of the beast and the bell.
I'm very much enjoying, and as we're going along, I'm writing questions, but as we're going along, you're answering them, both of you. So I'm finding that very nice. Just a comment that literally just came in, appreciating your honesty. And the comment is struggling with rejection in the past, which has in turn made me distrust and push people away before they can hurt me. So the question, how can we feel worthy of love when others have hurt or rejected us? So I don't know if either of you have any thoughts on that.
Wendy, you want to share something?
I was thinking about what you were saying, actually, and that was with me exactly where it was at, is that I did not want to be owned, possessed, pushed around, or dominated in any way. I'd been brought up to be extremely independent, I suppose, by parents who thought that, you know, after a war, I'd better be very independent. And the idea of finding a perfect relationship for me was extremely difficult, but I felt that I wanted and I had a lot of love to give. And when I got to be about 40, I was wondering what I was going to do with this. You know, it was quite a challenge. And one of the things that I thought would be nice that I like the idea of is because in France, where I was at the time, they have a rather nice organization, at least they used to in those days, I don't know now, where if you were happy to look after children, and I would have been, I would have been quite happy to do that, you become sort of a guardian for certain babies or children that are being abandoned. And they fill the house with the children, and you, the children grow up and you look after them as if it was a family. And it's done, it's not an orphanage, but it's a private enterprise where you are the mother of the house and you're the father of the house too, of course, obviously. But this sort of interested me, you know, this sort of attracted me, the idea that, you know, I could have something and someone to give this love to. I felt that I had a lot to share. And so that was the thing that I thought I might get into before I came into spirituality. Then, of course, you know, you realize that bringing up one or two children or three children, I'd had this thought too about having a child or two children or three children. I thought, well, you know, how selfish. You've got more love to give, actually. Why would you want to? It's a selfish attitude. Why would you want to have children, just one or two? And I was very perplexed. And of course, when I came into the Raja Yoga thing, the spirituality, I realized that there would be a lot of people that I could help and a lot of people I could give something to. And that it was not defined by a family or relationships or anything like that, that the world needed love and that it could be expressed in a much more general way. We sort of feel that love can only be given to, you know, people who are in a private relationship with us somehow. But I think that, you know, my love for animals is not limited to just the animals that I might possess, which I don't. I don't possess any animals. But that love emerges any animal that I see. And I think, you know, why can't we do this with human beings? You know, that human beings can be doing with a bit of love now and again. And so it was this that... I suppose, you know, this opportunity, this understanding that I would be able to give what I felt I had to give in a more unlimited way, in a certain sense, and make it less selfish. I was very afraid of selfishness somehow, of being selfish, of developing selfishness in my life. And I, because maybe I had actually lived quite selfishly, I don't know. But I didn't want that for myself. And so, again, I really didn't, you know, understand what was going to happen till I realized that that limited vision of love didn't have to exist, really.
And we know that love is, you know, a crucial ingredient in relationships, you know, in different forms. Love can hurt, love can heal, love can empower, love can destroy. Sure. And I really like that, you know, and the question also what I hear is how to, you know, feel worthy of being loved when we have been rejected a lot and when we have been, you know, ignored in our pure love. And I find it beautiful that even this movement, the Brahma Kumaris, started with the vision of giving women a voice, because very often they were deprived of a voice and of a role and of leadership. And I find that for me in the beginning, under the mask of ego, I thought I had self-respect and self-esteem and self-confidence, but it was actually all fake. You know, they were all expression of a strong personality, but they were not pure self-esteem or pure self-respect. And when I was thinking, am I being loved? I think for many, many, many times I was loved a lot, but not for all the good reasons. And I believe now that love attracts love. So selfish love will attract selfish love. Pure love will attract pure love. And if I learn to love myself in a way that restores my own dignity, which means to love myself maybe for different reasons than the ones I used to love before. I used to love myself sometimes because of my look, my capacity of performing, my personality. And I learned that I need to love another aspect of myself, which is more on a spiritual level. And I find that people who have been abused, who have been unloved, who have been rejected, can have such a low self-esteem, you know, that is very difficult to restore. But in the beginning, I was very, very allergic to this term love for the self. I don't know why. I felt very, it was almost incest for me to have love for myself. I was like, what do you mean? I should not have love for myself. This is wrong. You can't love yourself. I didn't like that expression. I thought it was just for New Age thinking. And I was very reluctant to that idea of having love for the self until I realized it was, again, my ego, who was arrogant enough that we can't love yourself. This is not man enough. You know, this is not compatible with my ego. And I had to really, again, break my ego to realize that loving the self is about being very humble in front of oneself. And it's being able to love the parts of myself that are sometimes very defective, very less lovable. But to look after them, maybe like you would be wanting to love kids that are abandoned or animals that have been abandoned. And I realized I had to regain trust in my ability to love the broken self that I was. And that love for me, that was not the most magnificent appearance of the self that the ego will create, loving my broken self or having mercy, having compassion, and realizing there's such beauty in the soul, that kind of, I think, made me feel worthy of being loved by others. And strangely enough, I always felt that I'm not worthy of people's love, because I think I was, you know, weak in my own ability to see the beauty in me, except the beauty of the ego. So it's connected to, I think someone is asking about why should the beast be there at the first place, since the beauty is within. Well, I think sometimes it's what we call the veil, you know, around the beauty and the ego, the wrong identities, the illusion. Sometimes it's called, so the veil in India, they call it Maya, the tricks. And the story, Beauty of the and the Beast, is based on that trick from that witch, you know, that cast a spell, on the prince. And I think we cast a spell on us, by betraying our true self. And if we don't respect who we are as beautiful, pure, spiritual being, then we curse ourselves. And we're told sometimes, if you don't love yourself, be careful, because you may be cursing yourself instead of blessing yourself. So I find the beast comes because the beauty is under an illusion. And, you know, it's a natural law. Old trees get old and they just get dry. So the beauty of the soul, you know, goes through time. And there's a time when the soul is weak and needs to be reawakened.
So a question come up for Eric, but let's hear first from Wendy your response. Yeah, please continue.
I can relate to that. I mean, I think we all, in the world today, we all have some hole in the soul somewhere. We all have, like you were talking about, abuse or whatever. In my case, it was rejection. And I developed a very strong personality and a lot of courage and a lot of strength within myself to prove to myself that I was going to be able to make it, whether I was being rejected or not. And this worked famously, actually. I mean, you know, but the thing was that, you know, you can do your best and work very hard to transform yourself to be what the other person would like you to be, but you are not. And that is the reason why they don't love you. And this, in this particular case, it was my mother. My mother wanted a boy, and when she realized she had a girl, she switched off completely. And I took years and years and years to try and prove to her that I was better than a boy. And this was very twisting, in a certain sense, to my own personality. But that was something I had to get out of as I grew up. With a lot of confusion, because, you know, I thought when I was very small, I thought, oh, well, you know, if you want it enough, you will grow up to be a boy. You know what I mean? I thought this was possible, which of course it isn't. We have those sort of strange ideas and thoughts as children. You don't, there's no logic to it, you know. But I must admit that being aware of these sort of things and being aware of the sensitivity that rejection might create in you because you have had that kind of a feeling is very helpful in a spiritual path. You know at least where your shady side or your negative side is. You realize the sensitivities that can be re-stimulated within relationships, and you know how to you know, shake it off, let's put it that way, because you've deactivated the buttons, let's put it that way. And so it took quite a while. I think, I mean, you know, this whole getting to know what oneself is really worth, you know, what are we really worth? We want to be loved for something that we are worth, not just because we're, you know, maybe something they want. That I felt was something that I tried to do throughout my life, is to make myself worthy of my own love in a certain sense, because the love of others, when I was very young, seemed to not be very obvious. It was not going to be very easy if you didn't become what they wanted you to become. And that was maybe why I was so resistant to maybe a husband making me what he wanted to make me. And that was, there was no way that was going to happen with me. And so, yeah, I mean, I can see the beauty and the beast within me. I can see the both that have been developed in one way or another. And I can see how useful those lessons are. And right now, I don't think that I'm either one or the other. I'm neither the beauty nor the beast. I'm sort of a something in between.
But did they kiss each other already? Did you have the kiss between the beauty and the beast, and now you are in that new kingdom?
Well, maybe we reconciled. I don't know.
Okay. Kisses later.
We reconciled to accept each other.
The kisses at the end of the story, actually.
The kisses at the end of the story, yes.
Oh, yeah. I really relate to what you're saying about this twisting to try to be loved or worthy of love, and how confusing it is because it's something going on inside. One thought that came is the beast or the ego that feels rejected, but Belle, who when she's clear, she knows her worth. That's my feeling of the spiritual message, the worthiness. Some comments have come up. In order to feel love, especially after being rejected, one needs to feel a certain level of security. Even though we are love, like Bella is, she's a loving being, it's the safety that will define how much we feel it. I thought that was interesting. Another comment: after 33 years of marriage and 3 boys, if she hadn't come across spirituality and true love, I know who she truly is, she would have headed for the hills, she says. A question to Eric. Could you share a simple moment, how you treat yourself or how you respond, in which you realize you love yourself? Does the question make sense?
Yeah. To me, it was after conquering, I would frame it as shame and fame. And I find that the ego has two personalities. There's an ego, in French we say an ego with a bump or ego with a hole. And on the street is the same thing. Sometimes you have a bump, sometimes you have a hole, and both are very bad for your car. So a side of the ego is to be proud and vain, you know, arrogant. But another one is to be shameful, to be ashamed of what is ugly within us. And one moment where I think I've been able to go beyond that was when I was told one day, oh, Eric, you know, because I was after a program saying hello to everyone, and it was probably nice to everyone. And someone said, oh, Eric, you love everyone. It's so nice to see you love everyone. And I was kind of saying, oh, yeah, thank you. Very nice. And I went home and I thought, do I really love everyone? And I thought, and my biggest realization on that day was, I think I'm very attached to the idea that I love to look like someone who loves everyone. And why? Because I want to be loved so badly that I'm trying to look like I love everybody. So I get to get everyone's love. And it was my ego, you know, I had to face my fame and shame and to tell both of them, it's okay. You want to look this way, but actually it's because you're ashamed of yourself and you don't feel worthy of being loved by everyone. So you're just playing a role just to look good. So everybody loves you. And then on that day, I know it's a strange little way to answer the question, but that day when I told myself was, it's okay not to love someone. It's okay, you know, not to be loved. And it's almost as if it reset my love, my love barometer or my love meter or my love scale, maybe like that. It reset my love scale at zero to say, don't play games anymore. Now we're going to love real. It's okay not to be loved and it's okay not to love. Just be real, be authentic. And from that day, I felt I could love without the shame of not being loved and free from the fear of not being loved. And I think we love from a very different point. We love from a very different type of heart, if you want, a very different position of the heart when we're not afraid of not being loved and we're not ashamed of not being loved. And that was for me when I started to actually love myself, because there was no expectation on myself and there was no ownership of my own love. It's like I said, the ego wants to own, but I was not. I was just witnessing a freedom to free myself from having to look like I love everyone and the freedom of being ashamed of not being loved actually by as much people as I wanted to be loved, because I was scared, you know, the fear was there. So I think that was the work of Belle overcoming her shame and her fear and her, you know, her not being aware of who she is truly. And it was the death of the beast in its ugly form to say it's okay to let it go.
That's very beautiful. You know, I felt for me personally that it was, you know, when you love, you've got to accept the whole package. You can't just love for one thing or just for two things. You have to accept the whole package. And I think that is a very sane attitude, because you can't, you know where the defects lie, but accepting them and loving and accepting even the negative part and accepting it as part of the whole character, you know, and loving someone for that in that way too. Or, you know, being happy to be somewhat distant and accepting that the relationship not go beyond certain limits, you know, of friendship, in other words. I mean, I think, you know, for me that there was that thing that there needed to not be just parts of me, talking about myself, not just parts of me that I could love and respect, because I knew how much effort it had taken to get there. I had to love also the part of me that was challenged, that was not always coming out on top, you know. And it was when I managed to do this that I started feeling much more peaceful with myself. I had no divisions within me. I was what I was, and I accepted the two sides of me, you know, the good and the bad, and the bell accepted the beast in a certain sense. And so I find that sort of balance extremely peaceful. I must admit, I don't find much inner fighting, personally. And I feel that that is probably after quite a number of years of hard work, you know, in a certain sense, and accepting and being tolerant, and not only tolerant with other people, but tolerant with self, you know, and going beyond one's own defeats. You know, you it's so challenging when you have been working so hard on something, or and you're defeated, you know, having to go beyond that and still keep up the good movement forward, you know, of completion, of being, of feeling oneself complete, you know. So that, I'm actually personally quite satisfied. But I've never put the bar very high. I mean, I've not sort of felt that I had to beat records or anything like that, which is maybe what made me find my balance fairly quickly.
I know what to offer you for Christmas, Wendy. I'll offer you the book of Belle and the Beast.
I mean, I looked for it on the internet.
Finally, read it.
I couldn't find it. I need the children's book. You know,
and I know I can send it to you. I can send it to you in French.
Oh yeah, that's very good. That's la belle et la bête. That's perfect. You know. Yeah, send it to me on email. But I looked for it very honestly, because I didn't know all the ins and outs of it. I just knew the very basic tale. I didn't know, you know, anything else about it. But I knew a lot of other children's stories, but not that one.
So, Sarah, we don't want to make that story longer than it is, but I know you wanted to conclude on time, so...
Yes, so just one sharing here that very much relating to the sharing and not judging the self when there's not ideal reaction, and to be able to respond authentically. And lots of thanks for an authentic and love-filled discussion. She took the words right out of my mouth. I think it's the honesty and the sharing of your real experience. And I think it may be that souls like yourselves are like paving the way, because I believe in leapfrogging, where you don't have to go through the same trajectory, but you learn from others' experiences. And I think we all, it's the time and the way the world is, we all need to come back to this inner beauty and do it quickly. So I feel very inspired hearing both of you, and lots of appreciation. Just to round up, I will just share actually on the screen before we have a meditation, that there is a talk in 1 month's time. Actually, it's kind of a follow-on, isn't it? Entering into relationships of happiness, could be continuation even. And I'll just pop in the chat now that if you're new to Raj Yoga, then you're welcome to join one of the weekly courses, and the recording link is there too. So would Eric like to perhaps create a bit of quiet time just to dwell on some of the things which have come up on this subject, just maybe for a couple of minutes if you would like? Thank you.
I invite everyone to just really give your body a little signal that you're going to disconnect from the body for a few seconds. So just move your body on the chair and just take a deep breath and make your body know that this is a moment where you want to go deep within, and you want to live the story of the self, the story of the soul. And sometimes it is good to imagine that we're entering a beautiful garden, because we're in a fairy tale. So imagine you're walking into this beautiful garden, hidden from the rest of the world. It's a garden that you know very well. It's an eternal garden. It's been there in your heart forever. And you just enter this beautiful, magnificent garden with so many colors and smells, and all the beauty of the garden makes you feel that this is really my own beauty, the beauty of I, the soul. And I'm just reconnecting with my inner garden, my inner beauty. And I know that deep within myself, there's an abundance of love. There's a fountain of peace. There's the colors of happiness just waiting for me to be there, to create the light in the garden. Because that garden cannot live without me, the light. So I bring light into this beautiful inner garden. And I take that beauty with me. And I say to myself that I am a being of love. That this is my true nature, my true self. That love will never abandon me. That love is natural. It's my natural way of being. And when I am love, it brings so much joy. And I don't feel only the sweetness of love, but the strength of love, the power of love. A love that can break all the illusions, all the ugliness in me, around me, in the world. Love becomes my armor. It protects me. And I see that love in me. I see how that love wants to express itself through my eyes, through my words, my hands. I am love. I give love. I radiate love. And I see the beauty of love. Oh, thank you, Sarah. Thank you, Wendy. It's lovely to be with you all.
Thank you so much.
Thank you also to Mahindran, Oliver, for keeping your cameras on. It's nice we saw you, connected with you. Whoever also is there, and Ganesh, hello. Thank you for your little word in private chat. And yeah, thank you for the invitation and lovely to be with the real beauty, Wendy.
Thank you all. Thank you very much.
And greetings and thanks from Istanbul as well. I just got private chat. So yes, we just, it's kind of going out there. And let's hold this Bella and look after her, that inner beauty. And thank you both for inspiring and for everyone for creating this space and this atmosphere. So see you all soon and thank you again. And enjoying that now it's the workshop time to put it into practice.
Thank you very much. Goodbye, everyone.
Bye.
Bye-bye.